That's when God's people have faith. But not only do they have faith, the Bible says there, in the rest of that verse, in verse 31, it says, and they were all filled and spake the word of God with boldness. When you have faith, you will be filled with the Spirit of God.
Hallelujah.
That's why we call ourselves Pentecostal.
Hallelujah.
We believe after you get saved, after you believe in Jesus as your personal Savior, there's more that God has for you, not just being saved, but He says, I'm going to give you the fullness of the power of my Spirit. I want you to have all the 9 gifts. I want you to have all the 9 fruits of the Spirit. I want your life to become so abundantly filled with God that you'll never, ever turn back. And I remember when they first told me about the baptism of the Holy Spirit, I didn't understand what it was. I was in a Pentecostal church, Sister Cover's church, years and years ago, 47 years ago. And the first time I ever went there, and some of you heard the story, but I was back there somewhere in a pew with a girl. Kind of reminds me of this too here. I was sitting back with my arm around, just like Anthony's guy's arm around Courtney there. I had my arm around this girl, and actually I didn't at that moment because we were standing up. I'll never forget this. And there was a message in tongues and an interpretation. And I'm looking everywhere through the church to see who could be speaking. There was a Chinese family there, so I thought for sure it was them. I didn't know. Honestly, I had no clue what was going on. I'll never forget this. And I'm looking. I'm like this. Everybody's worshiping the Lord, and I'm the only one, I think, in the whole church going, what in the world is going on around here? And here's these Chinese people. They're over there like this. Their mouths are not moving. I'm thinking, it's not them. Finally, I see the person that was doing it. You know, I thought, what in the world is this? So I couldn't wait until church was over so I could ask my uncle, what in the world was that? He said, that's the Holy Spirit. They were speaking in tongues. I said, what's that? He said, I'll tell you about that later on. It was some months later before I really understood what was going on in that Pentecostal church. They were just happy that I was going. I was a pretty bad guy. But God got a hold of my life, and all these things became real. I'll never forget the night I got filled with the Holy Ghost. I'd been in the church about 6 months, and actually I had to go with my dad to get pottery down in Zanesville. We was going for about 48 hours during a trip to get pottery to come up and sell my father's business. And I got in that night. It was about 5 o'clock in the evening. And Dad said, where are you going? I was rushing to the house to get my clothes changed. I said, I'm going to church. They're having a revival tonight. Never been to a revival before. Didn't know what a revival was, but I didn't want to miss it. I didn't want to miss it. I wanted to go to the revival. So I went to the revival, and guess what happened? I got filled with the Holy Ghost. Pastor preached with the Holy Ghost. I'm still not knowing too much about it. But I came up, and I was over on this side of the pew, by the altar here. I was just praying, praying, and he had my face buried down, and he came to me, and he said, son, the Holy Spirit's not down, the Holy Spirit's up. You better lift your eyes up. You better hold your hands up and ask him to fill you with the Holy Spirit. And I said, okay, sir. I lifted my hands up. I was so tired I could hardly stand. I hadn't slept in almost 2 days. I was so tired I raised my hands and said, Lord Jesus, this is real. I believe it. I need the Holy Spirit. I need the Holy Spirit. I need the Holy Spirit. I asked you to give me the Holy Spirit. You know what happened? The Spirit of God came down on me. I began to speak in other tongues. The Spirit of the Lord took over my life. That was the beginning of my journey. Got filled with the Holy Ghost. Spoke in tongues for some time under the presence and power of God. Went home that night. Went in the house, told Mom and Dad. They had no idea what was going on in my life. And so I wanted to have it again. So I went out. We had a big old tree in the front yard. I went out there and was walking around this big old tree. And I got down and I just started praying, God, I want this again. I want this again. I'm not going to bed until I get this again. And I prayed there under that tree for some time. Spirit of God came. I spoke in other tongues. And there was a spirit of the world. This is something else. And that was the beginning of my journey into Pentecost, into the presence of God, and the call of God, the purpose of God that He had for my life. And it's real. It's real. It changed my life. It gave me a reason to live. I'm telling you, I would be in prison right now, if not dead, if it had not been for the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. And God doesn't want us just to be filled. He wants us to be refilled and refilled and refilled and continually filled with the Holy Ghost. That's what happened. They got filled in Acts chapter 2, but he said that's not enough. In Acts chapter 4, they got refilled with the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. And they spoke the word boldly, and they were filled to overflowing. If you've never seen the baptism of the Holy Spirit, you don't know what I'm talking about. But I'm telling you, if you have, you know what I'm talking about. It's real. It's powerful. And it's wonderful, and God wants everyone to be filled. He says, this is the will of God. He speaks about it in Ephesians, where he says, this is the will of God. He says, therefore, be not unwise, Ephesians 5:17, but understanding what the will of the Lord is, and be not drunk with wine, where is in excess, but be filled with the spirits. Speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, and making melody in your heart unto the Lord. And that word, to be filled with the Holy Spirit, is in the continuous tense. It means be filled, refilled, continually filled with the Holy Spirit.
Hallelujah.
Paul said, I thank God I speak with tongues more than you all.
That's it.
I have learned to pray. I know how to control it. I know when the Spirit of God is upon me and how to use the gifts of the Holy Spirit. You read about it in the next, in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, 13 and 14. The operations of the Holy Spirit, the marvelous works of God. But Justin, is for you, it's for me, it's for whosoever will, that will call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and who will believe, as far as God will call in the generations to come. Acts chapter 2 says this is a gift that God wants for his church, and he wants us to have a power, a presence of the Holy Spirit to do the supernatural. And then you read about the workings of miracles and the gifts of healings, the discerning of spirits and speaking in tongues, interpretation of tongues, and all the marvelous nine gifts that God has given to us here at this church. And God wants to see those in operation, not just through some of us, but through all of you. And I'm so happy to have this guy right here, Devin, with us. And Devin, I remember Devin was born. He's a little squirt and run around in diapers. That's Cameron White and Lori White's son. Stand up, man. I can't believe it. I remember when he was born. That's how old this guy is. And we're so happy to have you with us, Devin. But Pentecost is real. It's been real. I remember when I first got saved, started going to church. They said, oh, it's just a passing fad. It won't last long. It's been 40, 30 years. It's still lasting. Why? Because it's real. Place was shaken because of their faith, and they were filled with the Holy Spirit. It changed their lives. And not only were they filled because of this presence, they were stirred. The people were stirred in verse 32. It says, and the multitude of them that believed were of one heart and of one soul. Neither said any of them that aught of the things which he possessed was his own, but they had all things common. I mean, they were stirred to their core. It was changing their life.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I mean, they would never be the same. They were going from house to house in fellowship. I mean, their fellowship had been stirred. And they met every day. Read about it in Acts chapter 2, Acts chapter 3, going up to the temple, meeting in the houses. They had something going on all the time. They were stirred. You ever see something stirred? It's just something was churning, something was moving in the church continually. They were not satisfied. They had something going on every night. It reminded me, you know, when I was in Africa, we had something going on every day of the week. Prison ministry, village ministry, hospital ministry. We had our young people would go with us up to the hospital. We'd be laying hands and praying for the sick in the hospital in the ward. They would go with me to the prison. And if they didn't behave themselves, I would just leave them there. I had a truckload. Everywhere I went, I had a truckload of people go with me. And we would go to the villages and we'd do knock on doors. We'd invite people and sound the alarm. People would come out of the woodwork. We had something going on every night of the week. Go week after week, year after year after year after year after year. It's still going on right now. How many we were there? They got some. We traveled all the way up country, all those hours. We get all the way up to Tacoma. And as soon as we pulled in, they said, Brother Ron, we want to show you a few churches. They said, oh no, not another church. Not another one. We were exhausted, 100 and some degrees in the vehicle, sweating and worn out. And we pull in. The first thing they said to us after we put our bags down is, it's almost running out of daylight. We have about 10 churches we want to show you. 3 we're exhausted. It's 5 o'clock. I said, let's go. David went, that's Africa. It's Africa. You'll vouch for that. And off we went, man. And we went to village after village after village after village. At least 10 churches we went and visited and seen the pastors and hugged them and took pictures. And that was so exciting how things have not changed. And they got this going on. They're building 8 new churches and they have these things planned. And oh, God is supplied. God is moving. God is doing things right now in Sierra Leone. But just absolutely thrill my heart. Over 100 churches now have been established. Just keeps growing and expanding. And they do not stop. They got something going on all the time, every day of the week. I mean, it's absolutely exciting. You know what? Because they are on fire. They are stirred. God is doing the impossible, and he is glorifying his name through them, and they have nothing else to live for but eternity. They've got the poverty of some, one of the weakest economies in the entire world. They have nothing to glory in themselves. All they have to is to glory in God and their fellowship. I'm telling you, it is strong. In this early church, I'm telling you, everywhere they went, they were just in fellowship one with another, of being used of God in total unity. I mean, unity. That's what fellowship is. It's two fellows in the same ship, and they were oaring together. They were pulling together, and they had unity. In Acts chapter 2, in Acts chapter 3, Acts chapter 4, we see the church moving together in one accord. I'm telling you, in one accord. That's the way they did it. In the day of Pentecost, 4 times it says, they were of one mind, they're of one accord. He started that way, and it was like that all the way. They had little bumps in the road, but they ironed them out, and they kept everybody united, pushing in the same direction. That's called real fellowship. Hallelujah. That means forgiving and understanding and loving and working through situations and keeping ourselves on the same page for the glory of God. They were united in their fellowship. They were united in their concept of lordship. It says, any of the things that they possessed were not their own. Hallelujah. Not their own. They believed with all their heart that their time, their treasures, their talents, everything that they possessed was not their own. They believed it was God's. Their cars, their houses, the bank account, everything. This is what I believe. It's not my own. God gave it, and God can take it. He can take it right now. We just don't know when. So we better just give it to him. Hallelujah. Because that's where you have a reward in heaven. Praise God. So you have this lordship and this stewardship. I mean, not just worship, they had a stewardship about them that if they saw a need, they sold their lands, they sold their property, and gave to the one that was suffering. They saw somebody struggling here, struggling there. They did what they could to unite the body and to strengthen the body. And so the ones that were educated would help the ones that weren't educated. The ones that were rich would help the ones that were poor. And they had this mixing together, just a beautiful picture. There was no color that would separate them. The blacks and the whites got along just perfectly well. There was no schisms and divisions, no racism and everything else. It was just beautiful, James. Beautiful. Come together just as one. Love each other. Forgive each other. Work through a situation. And there was no division there. Now they worked on keeping it harmonized for the glory of God. That's what I call a church on fire. Hallelujah. That's the church that will make a difference. And we got to work at it. It's not easy. We're going to fail. We're going to hurt. We're going to have disagreements and everything else. We heal it and we move on and we become what God wants us to become. Amen? Yeah. So it's increased fellowship, increased lordship, increased stewardship. Kept growing and growing and growing and expanding. And they held this as a criteria to keep the presence and the power of God in them. And then their purpose, they had a purpose that was sacred. This is with great power. They gave... The apostles gave witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. Great grace was upon them all. Neither was there any among them that lacked, For as many as were possessors of lands and houses sold them, and brought the prices of the things that were sold, and laid them down at the apostles' feet, and distribution was made unto every man according as he had need. The place was shaken, people were stirred, hallelujah, and their purpose was sacred. It wasn't about them, it was about God and what God wanted. It wasn't about numbers. It was about his name.
Amen.
And him to be honored and glorified. That's what it was all about. And they kept that ever before them. It was through the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ and the power of that resurrection that had changed their lives. And they had one message. And that message was the message of the gospel, the good news, that Jesus Christ came into this world, that he bled and died, but on the third day God raised him from the dead, and then on the 40th day he took him back to heaven, and one day he's coming back again.
Yes,
and that message was the message that burned in their soul and in their spirit wherever they went, whatever they were doing. They had a gospel, a good news to share with the world, and they were not ashamed of it. Paul said, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation. And that was their message. Jesus Christ and him crucified, risen, and coming again with life and liberty for all who will believe. And everyone said,
amen.
Amen. It's the same message. That's changed in thousands, 2,000 years, and it's not going to change as long as I'm pastor of this church. I believe that is the foundation. The foundation of this church. And no church will ever catch on fire if they do not believe that deep down in their very soul. We have no other message other than Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah.
Crucified.
Hallelujah.
Risen.
God.
And coming again.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
To the Lamb. Then they had a ministry that they practiced. Hallelujah. Your faith, your message doesn't mean a hill of beans unless people know you really care. They had a ministry. They shared. They cared. They seen a need. They reached out to that need. I don't care what it was. I have a boy by the name of Ryan. Need a 20-inch tire for his bicycle. He's coming to get it. To me, that's kind of a dumb need. But to him, that's real importance. Right? Where's our heart? Do we see the needs of those around us? Are our eyes even open to it? Do we have a ministry? Do we really care? Do we want to know this world? Our church is never going to catch on fire until we begin to open our eyes and get out of our own little world and begin to see a world that's going to have Jesus Christ. And you're not going to touch the heart until sometimes you touch the hands first. And sometimes a hug, a handshake, or just a listening ear, just a heart of compassion that reaches out to them. That's what the early church did, and they just shared and cared and looked and seen the needs and ministered to people. And I'm telling you, it mushroomed and grew into something explosive for the glory of God. And I'm telling you, that's what God wants to do, so that when we come together, people that have been blessed, people that have been helped, people that have been touched, all of a sudden erupt in praise and glory. A church begins to just revel in what God is doing and what God has done. And sometimes through them, sometimes for them, it just is changes but from moment to moment. But a real church that's on fire believes this. It's more blessed to give than it is to receive. And it brings a joy, it brings a peace, it brings a presence, it brings a power into the church that's indescribable. And God wants to do that in our lives here at this church. And it will be seen. It will be seen in your countenances and your faces and everything. There's a lady that belonged to a church, and she'd been in that church for years and years. But her husband never came, not one time, did he ever come to the church. And one day the church caught on fire and burnt to the ground. Pastor came, two-story, Oakland, Oklahoma. Pastor Kane was walking through the rubble of the church. And guess who was there? The husband of the wife that had never been to church. So the pastor was kind of taken off guard and asking, wow, I've never seen you come to church before. He said, well, I've never seen your church on fire before. True story. He was talking about a literal fire. I don't know if he's being sarcastic. I don't know if he's trying to get a point across the pastor. I don't know. Let's just say, I do know this. When people see a church on fire, God's going to do something. And they're going to see it in your countenance. They're going to see it in your ways of worship. When Tisha's up there pouring out her heart, trying to get people to sing, and you're sitting back there going, I'm not a singer. I don't sing. I don't raise my hands. I don't get excited about anything other than football and baseball. I'm not about to raise my hands and look like an idiot, even though the Bible says, lift up your hands, holy hands without doubt. Even though it says, clap your hands, all you people, shout unto the Lord with the voice of victory. Speak of yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, making melody in your heart unto the Lord. Playing the loud cymbals, we miss Robbie today. He's all the way in Pittsfield and he couldn't be with us today. Under a lot of pressure with his work, but making loud noises unto the Lord and magnifying God, I like to come to church. And sometimes the only voice I really hear is my voice, and I'm up here in the front. And I know I'm not back there, but I love it when I begin to hear. There's some songs you just get in on when I hear everybody start to say, "No, that just makes me so excited." I love it when I turn around and look and I see people with their eyes closed and their hands raised. The worship, I love that. I just love that. And nothing is more depressing than turn around and take a little look and see everybody back there going, there is a river that flows deep from Emmanuel's veins. Pulls and heals me and but I love it when I see people hands raised, tears flowing down their faces, lifting up their hands to the hills from whence cometh their help, knowing their help comes from the Lord, worshiping and praising Him with all of their heart. Not only do you have to lift your hands up the whole time, but I believe you need to be glad in the Lord.
Hallelujah.
You need to come rejoicing.
Yes.
You need to become thankful to God. You need to lift up your voices, and sometimes you just need to shout, hallelujah. I would love to hear Eugene someday just say, hallelujah. I would come unglued. I'd come back and I would take his pulse and say,
Lord,
call the doctor. Something's going on with Eugene. I won't use anybody else for an illustration. I could use quite a few here. You better never take me to a ball game, because if you do and you get excited one bit, I'm going to knock you in the head and say, hey. A church on fire can be recognized from a distance. Louise in Africa, our first church, we went to this church, the last African pastor we had, he was an alcoholic and sold all the benches out of the church. And the church went down to nothing. They transferred us to Port Loco to be the new pastor and missionaries on staff to rebuild the church in Port Loco. Can you imagine? We had a handful of people in this church, little mud block building, about 30 foot by 20 foot. It was a small building. And we started our little church. We preached and ministered and reached out to the community. And we've seen several people get saved. And it gradually grew to about 60 people over 2 years. Was a pretty good growth, but dead. I'd get up, preach my heart out, just like I was even worse then. Preach my heart out, sweat, no air conditioning, hot. Come out of there soaking wet, pants soaked, soaking wet every service. I'd kill myself preaching to these people, and nothing. I just couldn't get through. They didn't understand how to worship. They couldn't raise their hand. They couldn't praise God. I just couldn't understand it. This church was plagued by the devil and a depression, and the church almost sank. One of the elders had four wives and smoked and drank, and he was the leader in the church when I got there. That's who he drank with, the pastor. He lost his best buddy. He wanted me to go drink with him. I said, how are you going to be? So right away, he became my arch enemy. He stopped paying tithe. Because when he got up to put his two leonses, which was $2, man, that's a lot of money back then. I told him, sit down and shut up. We don't need your money. Exactly what I said from the pulpit. Because I was sick of the sin. Sick of what was going on in that church. And I thought, this guy is not going to run this church anymore. This one 21-year-old preacher is going to do my wife's witness. Exactly what happened. She was there. Wow! You'd have thought I'd committed the unpardonable sin. Called a church council, going to throw me out. I said, you're not throwing me out, I'm leaving. I said, I'm leaving for 7 days when I come back. I'm not sitting in any meeting with you guys or anything like that. You can throw me out if you want to, we'll pack up and leave. I said, well, I'm leaving for 7 days, so you can just pray. But while I was away, the guy dropped over dead. Dropped over dead, 40-some years old. Dropped over 40 years old, 40, 41. Dropped over dead. They came and got me and said, you better come. Mr. Kendrew died. Somebody's got to bury him. I said, let the dead bury the dead. I'll get home. I'll be home in 3 days. He's up in Messina. Believe me, this is the truth. We went back in 3 days. They already had him buried. I was about to bury that guy. The devil's buried him. We never did have the council. They never did meet with me. They were scared. I just said to them, do you want me to stay or not? Because we're ready to pack our bags and get out of here. Because there's a lot bigger fields than this. Nobody will want you to stay. Please stay. I said, well, there's going to be changes. There's going to be changes. We're going to begin to seek God. We're going to let God begin to do something here. Right after this, he's going to preach that morning, that evening, he's going to preach on the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And I told the church in the morning, I'm going to preach tonight the baptism of the Holy Spirit. I want you all to come. Okay? I started to go home, and as I got halfway home, we just walked, and he was in the same compound. My wife will bear witness to this. I told my wife, honey, I feel like I need to go back to the church and pray. I went back to the church, and I prayed all afternoon. I prayed up until about 5:30. Service started at 7. I went home and cleaned up. While I was praying, God said, tonight, I'm going to pour out of my spirit. These 7 people are going to be filled with the Holy Ghost. And I'm going to work a miracle in your eyes. I wept, I cried, and cried, and cried, and cried. I felt the presence of God was so real, I can still feel it to this very moment. One of those God moments don't happen very often, but when it happens, you never forget it. And then my wife had been very sick. And I asked God, I said, tonight, if you touch Kathy, heal her body. Let her shake from head to toe, and let her shout with the shout of victory. I want to know that she's healed tonight. God, if you'll do that for me, I would so appreciate it. And I got done praying. I went home, washed up on our way, walking to church that night. I told my wife, I said, God's going to do something tonight. I wrote the 7 names down in my Bible. I didn't tell my mom. I had them written down in my Bible. And just to make a long story short, I never did preach my messages. I began to preach. The Spirit of God took over that service. And God began to move upon the people. My wife was back there playing the accordion, and people just started coming. And the very 7 people that God showed me was going to fill with the Holy Spirit were all in the front pew. And they all got down and started praying and the move of God, and they started raising their hands. I'm up on the platform, and I forget what we were singing at that time, but we were singing, worshiping the Lord, and I'm just looking at all this happened before my eyes, and I'm going, oh my word, this is unbelievable. And all of a sudden, Paul Cannon over in this corner had his hands up. His dad is the one that died. His dad is the one that God smote. Paul's hands went up and he began to worship the Lord. As he went to worship the Lord, he came down off the platform, and as I went to lay my hands on him, the power of God hit him. He fell to the floor and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave utterance, and it was a move of God. And the Spirit of God, Richard, jumped up on the next 7 people. The very ones that God showed me he was going to fill with the Holy Ghost all fell under the power of the Holy Spirit. I never touched any of them. They just fell like dominoes. Whammo. I mean, the Spirit of God began to move. I've never seen anything like this in all of my life. And our church was set on fire. We've seen over 200 people get saved in the next 6 months. The move of God. They were standing in the windows looking in. About 100 and some people wondering what's going on in that little Pentecostal church at nighttime. It was an eruption of a revival. School teachers got saved. Young people got saved. The Spirit of God moved. Some are pastoring to this day. We got to set with Marconi, ate dinner in his house, and one of our first converts out of that revival, still serving the Lord, Ben Coley, serving the Lord, met us at the airport, different ones from that first revival, move of God, touched lives, hundreds of lives have been touched from that first revival and what it did for God. I believe God wants to do the same thing at Bethel. I'd love to see a move of God, signs and wonders and miracles, a church on fire for God, that when we come together, there would be no stopping of it.
Yes.
On fire.
Amen.
On fire. You know, you get a church on fire, you get their people on fire. And I was looking for a song, and I found the song that I wanted to play tonight, this morning. I asked him if he heard it up there. I want you to listen to the words to it. And I'd never heard it before. Actually, the song I was looking for, I couldn't find it. And this is the song that touched my heart. I went through several songs about fire. And this is the one I came up with last night. And I want you to listen to it, because it's what I desire for Bethel. It's what I desire for your lives. I desire this for my own life. I want to be on fire for God. I want to be so consumed with Him that all I can do is burn. Burn with passion for God. Hallelujah. And then Bethel will make a difference for the glory of God. Brother Tim. Most in America, in the church don't even want to go there. They're comfortable in their sin and in their pleasure and the life that they're living. As long as they have a square meal and as long as they can have the comforts of life, that's all that matters. As long as the pews can be padded and they have life made here, but not there. God wants the people in prayer. And I'll keep preaching this to the day I die. And I'll keep encouraging it. And I see in every one of our lives room for more growth, room to increase in our fellowship and in our stewardship and in our lordship with Jesus Christ. As long as I live, I know there's more there that needs to be kindled in my own heart towards God. A greater passion, a greater desire for Him. And if I can breed that in your life, I'm telling you, our church can be on fire for the glory of God. I would love it to see our young people used in the gifts of the Spirit.
Yes.
I would love to see signs and wonders and miracles. I would love to see them standing and preaching and touching lives. I was just a young man when I first preached my first sermon. And before I went to Bible school, I was leading songs in our church. I was 18. And the pastor was beginning to use me. And I was wanting to be used of God. He didn't use me right away. But you know why he used me? I was always the last one at the altar to leave. Sister Kobe's right there. You ask her. I was the last one to leave the altar. Everybody would leave. I would be there praying, crying, seeking God. I wanted His will more than anything else in the world. I went and got a bus. They had one, painted it, started hauling kids in. I would fill up a bus with kids every Sunday, bring them to church. So I'd go out and pick you guys up on Wednesday, and Sunday I'd go out in the van and pick up. Boy, I've done that all my life. Did that before I was a missionary, before I was a pastor, before I... Why? On fire. I wanted to see a soul saved, a life change. If I could see one young person go on to serve God. Man, I've had my fulfillments. I really have. My crown and my rejoicing are you. If I see you moving on and becoming what God wants you to become. That's my wife and I's goal. We got a bouquet of flowers today from a family in the church thanking us. And I called and I said, well, this is overwhelming. We don't need this. I said, you're our crown of rejoicing. Just being there. Loving God. Serving God. That's our reward. That's all I care about. Is when life changed. Nothing discourages me more than to see one lost. One going away from God instead of coming towards God. Their life not being fulfilled. Their purpose not being sacred, wanting God's will more than anything else in the world. But when I see that happening, it just thrills my heart. I want our church to be on fire. And I know I got to lead the way. I know the cost is great. And we need to pray. We need to believe. We need to stand together. Not one person's going to do it, but all together we can do great things for God. And I wonder how they would say, you'd love to see our church on fire.
Hallelujah.
You'd love to see our church on fire. I would love to see that. I know it can happen if we all get on board. So I want to stand. I want you to hold the hand. So. The Bible says we're to pray one for another. And that in that same verse, James chapter 5, that same verse. That same verse says, the fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. The fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. I believe this is, we'll pray one for another. We'll pray for our church and you pray for yourself. We begin to pray and believe God. Make it a devotion. Husbands, praying with your wife every day. Wrap your arms around them and pray for them. May I practice all through my ministry. Pray for my wife. We've wavered from time to time and done it religiously. But I'll tell you this. When a man does that, his home is solid. His wife is secure. They'll know they love you. It will have an impact that will set your house on fire. Get your house on fire. Get church on fire. Pray. 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 That is where it begins. Then it blossoms into something beautiful. Let's pray one for another right now. Right now. Pray for that one next to you. Hallelujah. 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 Lord, even as we open hands, it's a symbol of our unity here at Bethel. I pray, oh God, with a spirit of prayer, a passion for you. We begin to fill our hearts to burn deep within, Lord. We would begin to kindle a fire this morning in our hearts that when we walk out these doors, we would not be the same, but we want the fullness of the power of the Holy Spirit in our life. We would want more of you than we've ever wanted before, that we would go seek you with all of our hearts, God, that we might find you and experience you in new and greater dimensions than ever before in our life. God, I pray you begin to kindle that fire this morning. Even as we lay hands on one another and pray for one another, that Lord, we would transfer a fervency and a fire from our very being into the very next one to us. And Lord, together, we would begin to see something stirring in our midst. And we would see, oh Lord, that we have a sacred purpose and a plan that you have for Bethel, God, beyond ourselves, beyond these walls, Lord, into our community, into our state, into our country, oh Lord. And then God would begin to burn with revival fires within this church, God, stirring our hearts up like never before to be used of you more than ever. Oh God, let that happen. Let that happen, Lord. Let the Spirit go with us as we go home. Let the Spirit, Lord, rise within our soul. Let us desire more of you than we've ever had before, God. And Lord, we would see lives changed, miracles taking place, souls being delivered from sin, young people set on fire, being sent to the mission field to do works for God. Oh, Lord, and that you would begin to broadcast this message, this gospel, to the uttermost corners of the world through Bethel for your glory. Oh, Lord, rise up in our midst, Lord. Rise up, even as the flames of fire rise, so let us rise up in you. God, be a light in the midst of a dark world. God, that you would be glorified through all of us till you come. Till you come. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. But when you come, may you find us on fire. On fire. And I will praise you for it, Lord. I'll praise you for it. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. 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 These altars are still open. Anyone who wants to come and pray and take that time, the presence of God. It's so easy to walk out those doors and forget about everything we've heard. James talks about that. You look at yourself in the mirror of God's way, you turn around, walk away, and don't do anything about it. God touches your hearts. These altars are always open after service. Oh, I tell you what, I used to revel in those moments when I could come and kneel before my Maker and say, Lord, I'm not leaving here until I know you've done that work in my life. I want more of you. I want more of you. I see George coming. He's probably the sickest and the frailest of us all. But he always comes. Kneels at the altar. I'm telling you, God will reward him. God will reward you. And so if the Lord is holding your heart, I want you to come and tarry. Wait on the Lord. Whatever he wants to do in your life, let him do that. Will never regret it. It was there at that altar that my life was transformed. And the calling of God was performed in my life that has brought me to where I'm at today. I'll never forget it.